We are here today for the Mobile Crisis Unit County Panel, and we are fortunate to have three people here that are going to be sharing their experience, their wisdom. Kelly Johnson, Kristen Miller, and Daniel Ragib. We're going to do an introduction of each of them as we proceed on our slides. I want to say thank you all for being here. I'm checking out all of the folks that we have. Please feel free to share an organization that you're coming from, your name, your pronouns, anything that you like in the chat. My name is Ande Pena. I work with CARS, the Center for Applied Research Solutions, and I am with the CARE team. And I am a TA specialist. My pronouns are she, hers, and ella. I am very thankful to be here with you all today. Our presenters today, speaking about our mobile crisis units, are Kelly Johnson, the Senior Program Manager at Humboldt County Department of Health and Human Services Behavioral Health Department. We also have Kristen Miller, Behavioral Health Services Administrator, and she is supporting those that are working in the Riverside University Health System, Behavioral Health in Riverside County. And we have our own CARE TA member, and this is Danielle Ragib, and she is with us at the California Crisis Care Mobile Unit Project and with the CARE TA Center. And so we have three phenomenal people that are bringing a wealth of knowledge into this space. And we have approximately 8 questions, so I will go ahead and move through these slides fairly quickly so that we can move into our learning objectives. The first one is that we learn about mobile crisis teams in a northern and southern county in terms of stage of implementation, type and size of programs, staffing structures, and other logistics that people feel are important to building, launching, and progressing their mobile crisis unit teams. We will also hear how each team develops strategies to overcome barriers in general and those specific to challenges of COVID-19 and other natural disasters and experiences that people have had in 2022. Last, we will discuss common staffing challenges faced by mobile crisis teams and best practice approaches to addressing those challenges. As we move into this session, we will be adding in panel questions. Our first question as we open up this space, and I'm intentionally going to be going in an order so that it provides an opportunity for each person to share first and to also support with a closing comment. If people have information that they feel has been already stated, they can underscore and when we might move through it that way just for the sake of time. So first of all, our first question as we join the panel is if you can please describe your county mobile crisis team and general information about your county. And we do this so that people that are in our audience can understand the dynamics of the county that they're representing so that they can figure out how does this connect to the work that I'm doing. And so we will go ahead and get started with Kelly Johnson, and again from Humboldt County. Can you please describe your county mobile crisis team and general information about your county with the audience?
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. I am representing Humboldt County in Northern California, which is a small population-wise county at just over 136,000 people, but a very large geographically-wise county. The county seat is Eureka, California, and it can take more than 2 hours to reach certain parts of our county. And we've had a mobile crisis team in some fashion over the last 5 years, although we didn't have funding for the program until April of 2018, when we were awarded a grant through SB 82 funds. And that grant unfortunately ended in November of last year, and it allowed for us to fund 2 full-time clinicians, 2 peer coaches, and 1 case manager. And we have them scheduled in sister schedules, so they cover 7-day a week coverage, working either Sunday through Wednesday or Wednesday through Saturday, 10-hour shifts. working from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. So there's a peer coach, which is a person with lived experience in the behavioral health system of care, who's partnered with a clinician who does crisis assessments in the field. And those folks work 7 days a week. And then the one case manager works Monday through Friday to provide aftercare support and linkage. Our goal has been to increase to 4 clinicians so that we could expand our hours to 11 p.m. We have not been able to ever hire more than 2 clinicians at one time, so we've never been able to expand our hours, unfortunately. We do have some after hours crisis support, depending on the level of type of call it is. So we have 6 clinicians trained in our department to respond to crisis negotiation team callouts in co-response with law enforcement. So that's a higher level type of crisis intervention than we usually do with our mobile crisis team, but those folks can be called upon at any hour of the day or night. Our program serves adults, although we do have a children's mobile crisis team in our county as well, but they operate a little differently. And so today I'm only speaking about the adults team. Since the pandemic, we've primarily only been providing crisis assessments in our local emergency departments, and that's due to the COVID mitigation strategies that were put into place in our county. Previously, law enforcement was able to bring people directly to our crisis stabilization unit and our psychiatric health facility when they were placed on a 5150 hold. However, during the pandemic, they were diverted to the emergency departments for COVID testing and medical clearance. That led to an almost tripling of the workload for our mobile crisis team, and we were responsible for doing all of the evaluations for people in the emergency departments. The original goal of the team was to be more in the field, to provide proactive upstream interventions prior to people being placed on 5150 holds. And unfortunately, the pandemic just really derailed that plan. So what happens is, for the majority of the pandemic, we were doing our assessments remotely by video. About 3 months ago, we returned to in-person assessments, which is great. It was not as person-centered as I would have liked it to be doing it via video. And so now we're back in person, so that's great. What will happen is the clinician will assess whether or not the person really needs psychiatric hospitalization, or if we can meet their needs at a lower, least restrictive level of care. We will wrap services around them with a peer coach and a case manager to help them link to ongoing outpatient services if they do not need psychiatric hospitalization. We know that that process can be very traumatic for folks, so we don't want people to be hospitalized unless they really need to be. We do still provide some assessments in the field. Our capacity is getting somewhat better over the last month, due to other capacity issues that I'll talk about more later. We've been able to do more of those field interventions prior to people being placed on 5150s, which is great. In the last fiscal year, we completed 862 assessments. Out of those 862, 599 of them, we upheld the 5150 or wrote a 5150, meaning that we felt that they did meet criteria for psychiatric hospitalization. And we were able to rescind 263 of those holds. So I think that is, in a nutshell, my general information for you about
that. Is amazing. Thank you, Kelly, also for giving the explanation of the county that you're coming from and the approach that you're taking. And I love that you're naming that you, as a county, were leaning in instead of moving back when dynamics changed. Naming the challenges that you experience, which I think we're going to hear a lot about today in staffing, and then also challenges of removal of the personalization with COVID and having to move into video links and things like that. And so I just appreciate you naming all that you have. Thank you, Kelly. We will move over to the county that will be joining us is Riverside. And this is Kristen Miller. And if you can please describe your county mobile crisis team and some general information about your county as well. Thank you.
Sure. Good afternoon, everybody. Again, I'm representing Riverside County, which is the fourth most populated county in California. It's urban, so it's, and we also have, like Humboldt, a large geographical area to cover. From the beginning of our county to the end, it probably takes about 4 hours to travel the entire county. We have Blythe, which is right on the border of Arizona. And so we have a couple of different mobile crisis response teams that I can share with you. One of those is our CBAT team, that is our community behavioral assessment team that was established in 2007. And it was a team of one, and it remained a team of one for quite some time. That is a team that is a co-responder team with law enforcement. So we have a clinical therapist that's paired with law enforcement. And so we had that team in 2007. It struggled. The partnership wasn't quite where we wanted it to be. And so when we lost that clinician, as they moved on to a different position, it remained vacant for a while. And then we were able to reestablish that program in 2014. And from 2014, again, it was one team with our seat cities, Riverside. And it has now expanded to 17 teams throughout the county. And so since 2014 to now, we have 17 of our community behavioral assessment team out there serving. And they respond to 911 calls that have a behavioral health, more of a behavioral health nature to the call. And all of our team's focus is a diversion. So we're doing everything we can to try to prevent unnecessary hospitalizations, unnecessary arrests, really helping wrap supports around individuals so they can stay safely in the community or use lower levels of care. As Kelly mentioned, you know, we want to be trauma-informed. We understand that hospitalizing individuals against their will is definitely something that's traumatic. And so we're doing everything we can to try to prevent that. The other type of team that we have is a mobile crisis response team. And that is a team of a clinician and a peer support specialist. So much like what Kelly described, this is someone who either has their own personal lived experience or a family loved one who has personal lived experience with having a behavioral health diagnosis. And that is our mobile crisis response team. We've had those teams since 2014. And we have 12 of those teams currently that serve our vast geography here in Riverside County. And then we have a third type of team, which we have as a mobile crisis management team. Our mobile crisis management teams are clinical therapists, substance use counselors, case managers, and peer support specialists. And this team of four does the same thing. It does crisis response, but it also can do more ongoing case management for individuals who are going to need that. Rather than the crisis assessment and linkage, they can provide ongoing outreach and connection and service to make sure that people really don't repeat that crisis and can get connected to the services that they so much need and deserve. Those are brand new teams for us. We started those in 2021, and we were very, very, very fortunate to receive some grant funding to be able to expand those teams. And so we will have about 19 of those teams throughout our county. We're in a huge growth stage, which is a different question that I can talk more about, but we're very excited about those. We don't have criteria to our services. We really do everything we can to try to practice the Crisis Now model of anyone, anywhere. The only thing we do, we have a crisis call-in center, so our stakeholders and program partners call in requests for services, and our call center staff are really assessing for safety. How safe is it for our team to respond? Can we send a mobile crisis response team? Do we need a CBAT team to respond? But we see everyone anywhere. We are not 24/7, which I hope someday that we might be. We are 7 days a week, from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. We do have some very limited overnight response for special projects like BERS, but for our call center, it does close at 8 p.m. It rolls over to our mental health urgent care to do triage. And our mobile crisis response team saw over 2,400 people last fiscal year. We were able to divert 50% of those individuals away from a hospitalization. But much like what Kelly described, we also see people who are already on 5150s in emergency departments on occasion. And so that factors into our data. Our CBAT team saw over 1,400. And we had six teams last fiscal year, and we now have 17. So we're rapidly growing. We do have a local crisis line. Our 686 helpline is fantastic, and they will dispatch. They will connect with us, and we can dispatch out teams to individuals who call their line who need support. And I just want to briefly mention that we are very lucky to have a crisis support system of care, and that we do have our mental health urgent cares, which are 23-hour crisis stabilization units where our teams can take individuals who need more support. In Riverside County, we have Safe House, which is a place where adolescents can go if they need more support, especially if family dynamics are challenging. And then as a last resort, of course, we have our emergency treatment services. So I think that's an overview of Riverside County.
Thank you so much. And I appreciate that you're bringing into this conversation the innovative and thoughtful ways that we can braid funding so that we can create flexible approaches that can meet the needs that exist in our communities. And so I really appreciate all of that. And also touching on the adolescent piece, bringing us back to the opening discussion that we heard from our keynote this morning, meeting the needs of our adolescent youth as well. So thank you so much, Kristen, for the information that you're bringing in from Riverside. And we will move over to Danielle, who is bringing us information from two different roles. She is in a transition right now. And so we actually get like a two for one with talking with Danielle. So thank you so much for being here, Danielle. And if you can share with us the county mobile crisis team that you were working with, and some general information about the county that you are working in. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Danielle Ragib. Like Ande said, I am with the CARE TA Center, and I am also on the California Crisis Care Mobile Units Project, working with grantees, kind of either implementing or planning implementation of a mobile crisis unit or kind of expanding. So my perspective is a little bit different. The information I'm bringing is a little bit different. I come from mobile crisis response. So I was previously a mobile crisis responder, so an actual clinician in the field in Orange County, and working specifically with children, youth, and adolescents. So the county had two separate teams, one for adults and one for children. And I was specifically on the children's team, so responding to calls within the county, countywide, so anywhere in the county, for anyone under the age of 18. I was specifically working for the mobile crisis assessment team, which is typically a multidisciplinary program that provides response within the county when an individual is experiencing a behavioral health crisis for a level of care determination. The program operated 24/7, so year round, and we had three shifts, so AM, PM, and NOC shifts, so we were always in operation. We, as clinicians, we did receive specialized training to be able to perform the evaluations and conduct risk assessments for suicide and danger to others. So danger to self, danger to others, and for someone who may be gravely disabled. We were not co-responding. We would go out on our own. We did not go out in teams. And we did operate in person throughout the pandemic. So typically responding to emergency rooms, homes, schools when they were in session, or out in the community if needed. A little bit about the county, and this is just some data from the census in regard to the population that I was responding to. So in Orange County, the percentage of people under 18 is 21.7%, so nearly 22%. And again, the goal of our mobile crisis response team was to divert. So really kind of link families, one, make a level of care determination, and then link families to either services, children and families to services, or partnering with the local crisis stabilization unit. And of course, if hospitalization was needed going through that process as well. That is pretty much what I have to share in regard to that.
Thank you so much. Danielle, I'm going to come right back to you. So don't go far. We are going to move into our next question, which is, what stage of implementation is your MCU currently in? And I know, Danielle, this may be you can speak to kind of where you were at, that's fine. And anything else you want to add to the question? Thank you.
Yes. So stage of implementation, I mean, the program was operating fully, like I said, 24/7. And the staffing unit was, the staffing model was 5 days a week, 8 hour shifts, so three shifts a day. The program has been around for quite some time. I can't remember exactly how many years, but it's been around for over 12 years. And like I said, the programs are separated, so they have an adult unit, they have a children's unit, and there's also a psychiatric emergency response team that co-responds with law enforcement. And again, I don't have much to say just because I wasn't in that role. My role was specifically as a field responder.
Which is awesome. Thank you, Danielle. We'll go ahead and move over to Kristen. If you can share with us, what stage of implementation is your mobile crisis unit currently in? And you've talked about growth, so this is exciting.
That is our stage for sure. We are in a growth stage. Our program went from 2 supervisors and 50 employees to 5 supervisors, and we'll have 142 employees. It's amazing. I can't even express how excited we are. I've been a part of the teams since 2014 when we first started them. To see them expand this way and really meet the needs of the community is amazing. I think with regard to the question, some of the challenges of this growth stage that we're in is time. Having the time to really get everything moving together in the way that we need it to do this kind of giant growth. Staffing and space are the other two challenges. When we first started these programs in 2014, we were fully field-based. You had a county vehicle, a laptop, a cell phone, an air card. You had everything you need to be in the field, and you didn't have any dedicated space to you to start and end your day. And we learned quickly that that wasn't going to be conducive for employees. They didn't feel a sense of value of, you know, I have a little niche for myself here that I can, you know, call my own as part of a program employee. And so this time around in this growth stage, we've corrected that. Now everybody has a cubicle, a something or other that they can call home. And so this time around, that was one of the first things we really started focusing on, is where can we make sure that every employee has some space that they can call home. And so that's been a challenge, but we're really lucky to have a lot of great partners. So law enforcement is hosting some of our teams. Our school districts are hosting some of our teams if we don't have space in our, because what we want to do is geographically center them throughout the county so that they can have really good response times and each area of our county has access to mobile response. And then staff, I think this is something that was probably going to be heard quite a bit today, is, you know, finding crisis workers, right? So we know, we've heard from our Crisis Now partners that those folks who want to work in behavioral health, it's usually about 15 to 20% that are really wanting to do and good at crisis work. Oops, I lost my lights. I didn't expect that to happen. But yeah, so finding the right staff for the program, and then retention with all of the competition out there. So those are a few of the challenges that I think we're experiencing in the growth stage, but we're all very excited about it.
Yes, very much. The growth is impressive, amazing. And also speaking to the region that you're in and wanting to have spots centralized so that responses can happen quickly. Thank you. We will go ahead and move over to Kelly in Humboldt County. Can you share with us the stage of implementation that your mobile crisis unit is currently in?
Sure. I wish I could say we are experiencing as much growth as Kristen. I'm envious. We've definitely been trying to grow our team, but the staffing is really a major barrier for us. I would say that we're more in a restructuring phase. We're looking at possibly combining our children's and adults team to support with capacity. The children's team sees much fewer folks than the adults team does. And so there may be some days where they don't have any clients to see, where the adults team is, you know, bursting at the seams. So we're looking at that. We're meeting regularly with all the stakeholders in our department to figure out what that may look like. We also did apply for and receive a couple grants to support expansion of the team or different teams in a different direction. So we have a grant to create a co-responder team with our sheriff's office to basically fill that niche that we had intended our mobile crisis team to fill and then got derailed by the pandemic. That being said, I've been unable to fill staff positions for this new team. So we're really just trying to find creative solutions and growing our own and looking at how we're filling positions and what level of education is needed and how can we utilize peer coaches and case managers to support some of this work when it doesn't need somebody who's a licensed clinician. Since licensed clinicians are the hardest to come by in our county, and I assume lots of these other counties that are here. And then also just changing our priorities as things are settling down with COVID. Our psychiatric health facility and our crisis stabilization unit are finally back up to their full census, which is the first time in 2 years. And so that was having a major impact on how we were able to have operations. We really didn't have capacity to do anything except for ED assessments. And so now we're able to start looking at what the field responses could look like outside of the emergency departments.
Well, congratulations on the funding and the thoughtfulness in utilizing that funding to continue the goals that you have in your county. Oh, okay. So our third question, and Kelly, I'm going to come back over to you as we move back down the line there. What are some of your program successes? What barriers is your mobile crisis unit facing? And what strategies is your county using to overcome those barriers?
Yeah, so I would say one of the biggest successes is improved relationships with our community partners, with the emergency departments and law enforcement. That being said, it's also been strained throughout the pandemic, you know, things that are outside of our control. But I think having those pre-established relationships going into the pandemic allowed for us to be able to work through some of these really extreme challenges together collaboratively. And so I think that's going as well as it can. And then in terms of, so I guess that was a barrier in a success. and then also I think, well, I'll add to that. I wear many hats in our county, which is common in rural counties. So I also am the crisis intervention team coordinator for Humboldt County, meaning that I provide training for law enforcement and do regular stakeholder meetings. And so I've been able to leverage those relationships to be able to address some of the issues that have come up around the crisis continuum of care. So that's a success. And then a barrier, as I've mentioned, and we've all mentioned, the staff recruiting and retention is just honestly a nightmare. It's been really difficult. And so the creative solutions we found to that are cross-training staff in other programs. One of the things that we did is we took our crisis stabilization unit clinicians and cross-trained them to work on our mobile response team, because during the pandemic, their census was so low, they really didn't have much to do on the crisis unit. So we were able to pull them to help support with the crisis assessments in the field and continuing to look at other staff throughout the department that we can encourage to consider trying crisis work. So I think a lot of the outpatient clinicians feel really cozy in their offices and don't feel comfortable doing crisis work. So just talking to them about it and explaining how this is really valuable and that we're able to, you know, support people accessing services at a lower level of care by providing this work or providing this service. And so that's worked in some cases, not in others, but we'll keep trying.
Thank you so much. And you're answering a question that Paul posed in the chat. And so I knew that we were going to have questions around staffing, and I love hearing creative solutions that your county is taking. And so thank you, Kelly, for bringing that information to us. And we will go ahead and go over to Kristen and also look at successes, barriers, and how we overcome those.
Yes, so we do have quite a few successes. Since I'm in administrative role, I definitely love to hear those from our field staff, because that's what inspires us, right? To do the work that we're doing. My favorite successes are those in which our consumers have really benefited from when the village comes together. So we have our field crisis response. So we'll respond to somebody possibly who's in crisis and then assist them and help them get to our mental health urgent care, which is a crisis stabilization unit, a voluntary, you know, 23-hour place that they can get extra support. And then from there, they can then get into one of our crisis residential treatment programs. And so we've had that happen quite a few times. And I think of one particular success in which an individual went through that kind of crisis system of care and was at our crisis residential treatment program for about 3 weeks, and there wasn't a solid discharge plan. There wasn't a great plan for what was going to happen next. And so the provider reached out and said, you know, what can we do? You know, we don't want this person to go back to being unsheltered, which is when we first met them. And there's progress, and, you know, we wanted to keep going, help him find his recovery path. And so we were able to get one of our mobile crisis management teams to come out and wrap some services and supports around him and really help him find supportive permanent housing. Actually, it took a lot of work and it took a good amount of time and an extension and some of those things, but it really, and this happens frequently in our system of care. And I don't think we stop and celebrate these kind of experiences enough to remind us of what we're doing and why we're doing it. But I just love it. It took the whole, and then we have a hope and housing department that had to get involved. So it took really a large portion of our system to wrap services around and make sure, you know, that people are getting, again, the support that they need and deserve. So that's an example of one of our successes. And then challenges, I mentioned the staffing, but one of the things we do have when on the opposite side, we do really need to help get somebody into urgent emergency care by possibly placing them on a 5150. We struggle with hospital beds for those individuals. And a lot of people are stuck in emergency departments, not getting that full psychiatric care that we want them to. And it takes a while. And sometimes it doesn't happen. Sometimes the 5150 expires in the emergency department. And that's a challenge we've seen for a long time. I think it's kind of a California thing. It's not necessarily just a Riverside County thing, but it's very hard to see and, you know, and really hope that we can get some change. I know our county is working on growing hospital beds and more contracts and things like that, but that's definitely one of the challenges that we've experienced as well.
I think knowing we are not alone in our challenges is so important. And I appreciate you, Kristen, for raising those. They are not isolated, like you said, to Riverside. They are things that we are experiencing across the state. And it is very difficult to navigate. So I appreciate that. Thank you. Danielle, we're going to be talking about successes and barriers that you experienced and innovative ideas to overcome barriers.
Thank you. Just like Kristen and Kelly mentioned, partnerships were really important as someone out in the field. So having, and that was, you know, our administration kind of building those partnerships and making sure that we had those options for the children and families we were serving. So I feel like those were great successes for us. So whenever we were determining out in the field that, you know, this person did not need a higher level of care or inpatient hospitalization, we were able to link them to some sort of service that really best suited their needs in the moment for their crisis and to help stabilize them and get them to additional services later at some point. In terms of challenges, you know, some of the biggest challenges, definitely staffing. I will say that the trend while I was with Orange County was more so just burnout, not necessarily from the work, from crisis work. I believe someone said earlier that there's a small percentage within the behavioral health workforce of people that actually like crisis work and are good at it and want to do it. And I feel that the supervisors of the program that I was working for were really good at recruitment and hiring of the staff in terms of how they interviewed people, onboarding, training, all of that was really great in terms of the strategies that they used. However, as you know, most of us are here, worked with counties or are working with counties, there's a lot of red tape bureaucracy that you have to get through sometimes in terms of salaries and things like that. And so people would leave, they wouldn't stay very long, right? Because they got burned out in terms of the level of work they're doing, the acuity of it. And just, you know, working 5 days a week in crisis, 8 hours a day was not helpful. There was no time for respite. So, you know, another challenge was the schedule. You know, as a team member, we were begging to have our schedules change, right? Get per diem staff so we could have a break, right? Because we were working 24/7 every holiday. We didn't get Mondays off when those Monday holidays would come around. So people get tired of that. Now, a lot of the people that left, including myself, were still in crisis care, still doing crisis work, just not for that entity anymore. And so when we think about burnout, it's not necessarily burnout for the work, it's burnout for where you're at. I can't see the question anymore. You moved ahead, so I can't remember the question.
That's fine. It's looking at successes, barriers, and how did we navigate through the barriers?
Yeah, so navigating through the barriers, I mean, there were a lot of conversations about what would be helpful for the field staff, right? What would keep them, what would help retain them? But again, going back to that kind of red tape that comes along, unfortunately, with government agency is to get around it, right? How do we raise salaries without doing a long, you know, and a carried out like salary study and things like that? And so as I was leaving, there was a lot of people leaving. And so turnover was happening very quickly, faster than what it was. So when I had been there, people were staying for a few years and then moving on. But it seemed to be happening faster as earlier in this year.
Thank you, Danielle. There is a request for contact information. If anyone is open to putting that into the chat while we move forward in the panel. And I also recognize that we are fortunate enough to have others in the room that are also in growth or maintenance stages for their mobile crisis units. So feel free to add any contact information for follow-up questions if you would like to do that in the chat. I will move to question 4, which is a technical question that kind of addresses some of the discussion we've been having so far. If you can please describe any challenges related to hours of operation and staffing, how does your program manage holidays, weekends, and evening shifts? So this is a technical question. Thank you. And Danielle, if you can answer that one for us.
Yeah, so as I stated, the team that I was working on, the crisis assessment team in Orange County for children, youth, and adolescents was a 24/7 program. So open every single day of the year, operating every single day of the year, and obviously all hours of the day. And so we worked either the shifts were Sunday through Thursday or Tuesday through Saturday. So you were always working one weekend day. You worked, we did have an evening shift, so overnight shift. Our shifts were 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., 3 p.m. to 12 p.m., and then 12 p.m. to 9 a.m. So those were the three different shifts. Like I said, holidays, if you weren't requesting it off specifically and using your time, you were working, and you were always working at least one weekend day. So you can imagine in terms of just longevity for people being able to manage that, it's hard because you're always having to give up a weekend day. And so it makes it hard for planning your own life and doing things that are fun and enjoying life with other people that aren't in this field or doing this kind of work. And so from someone who was directly working on these shifts and within this, I definitely saw the burnout there. And then you would also see high numbers of people calling out, right? Calling out on the weekends, calling out on a Monday, and then not enough coverage on the holidays, things like that. So I do feel that there could have been a lot of planning around this and how could we have changed it to make it work for the team, right? In terms of retention and getting everyone to kind of be, you know, be at a place where they feel good about their shifts and not burnt out by their shift. But that's what we were doing.
Thank you, Danielle. I love the honesty that you're sharing with. This is what it is. It doesn't necessarily mean that this is the perfect way to do it. And naming that we want to be creative. And we talked a moment ago about encouraging people on other teams even to join our mobile crisis units and things. And so how do we create prevention efforts to sustain the amazing team members that we have? Thank you, Danielle, for naming all of that. And we will go ahead and go over to Kristen. If you can please describe challenges related to hours, operation, staffing, and then how do you manage holidays, weekends, and evening shifts?
Yes. So everything Danielle said sounds like we're reliving 2019. In 2019, in the middle of COVID, our teams were fully functioning. They were seeing COVID positive, you know, individuals in the community. It was a very stressful time for our field response line staff. And we saw that burnout and call offs that Danielle's completely describing. So one of the things we were able to do was look at those schedules, and we were able to move folks from a five day a week to, if they worked a weekend, a 4-10. If they worked, they didn't work a weekend, then they would get a 980 schedule. And so we built in some incentives to try to really acknowledge that, yeah, giving up a Saturday or Sunday can be asking a lot. And so, and we recognize that. So those schedule changes really did help. It reduced call-offs, and the morale seemed to improve with those schedule changes. I saw a couple of comments about staffing. You know, and how we're doing it. We're struggling. I want to make sure, you know, I'm not painting this perfect picture that we're not struggling with staffing, because we are. We have vacancies and we have turnover. Our whole department is experiencing a challenge with getting clinical therapists. So not just crisis clinical therapists, but just clinical therapists in general. And we all band together and came up with a proposal for it to go to our board of supervisors. And it's getting ready to go now at looking at salary increases. So you can create change. It does take a long time in government, I know, but we're really close to getting those salary changes for our clinical therapists, because we need to be able to compensate people, right? So that's one of the things that, you know, we are doing that I think is going to help. As I mentioned, we aren't 24/7. We did have operational hours that were beyond the time that we operate now. We operated until midnight, until 10 p.m. at one point in time, and we recognized that was playing a part in our staffing issues and getting people to work that late at night, especially when the calls for service were really low. And so people felt like their time wasn't meaningful. So we did change our program hours, which now that we're in a place of growth, we're looking at, you know, possibly expanding them again, but we did reduce them in a way to retain staff and make sure that, you know, we have people available to respond to the calls that we're getting. And then we actually don't respond on holidays. So if it's a county holiday, we don't require our teams to work on county holidays. So those are some of the things we do. There's pros and cons, of course, to both of those strategies. But, you know, at the end of the day, if we don't have staff who are here to do that work, then we don't have much. And so, you know, we do everything we can to try to build in a place that people want to come to work and that we can retain the amazing crisis workers that we have.
Thank you, Kristen. And also just for naming, like, I think people were getting an imagination, like a thought of what it was like in your county. And so I love that you're bringing the realness to it too as well. Thank you. And so we'll go ahead and move over to Kelly. And if you can talk to us about scheduling and how you navigate that in your county.
Yes, I definitely resonated with much of what both Kristen and Danielle had to say. Our staff are expected to work weekends and holidays. They work the 4-10 schedule, either Sunday through Wednesday or Wednesday through Saturday. And it's a hard sell for a lot of people. And I feel really blessed that I have two staff right now that it works for their lives. But I think that's why I've never been able to have more than two clinicians, because how do you get people to give up their weekends every week, you know? And one of those clinicians worked both weekend days for a year and a half because we were short-staffed. He finally was able to take Saturdays off again, which has been great, but it's tough. There's been times that I, as a manager, have had to fill in on weekends or holidays, and the supervisor, which is a challenge. And I mentioned earlier, we've cross-trained our crisis stabilization unit staff, so they were able to help with some of the coverage on the weekends and holidays during their regular shifts. If there's somebody that had called out sick or, God forbid, took a vacation, you know, it's challenging for sure. We also always have an administrator on call, on duty, on weekends and holidays, which I think I'm the only one that's trained to do the work. And so I will, in a pinch, cover if I'm on call. But otherwise, the administrators on call can at least help triage if there's a staffing issue. We've also, with the support of North Coast EMS, created trainings for our emergency room physicians to be able to write and resend 5150 holds. And so that's been something that, because we're primarily in the emergency department, departments these days, that's been able to help them with their capacity issues. If law enforcement brings somebody in on a hold that really isn't appropriate, the emergency room physicians can resend those holds. And we've worked out a system where they can fax us the paperwork and then we'll do the follow-up care with our peer coaches and case manager. We've explored paying our mobile response team staff hazard pay, which is only a 95-cent an hour increase. Unfortunately, in our county, that's only available to people that worked in locked settings, so in our jail or on our psychiatric health facility. So I'm not sure where we're at with getting that moved forward. The salary thing, also an issue. We had a work and class comp study done several years ago, and nothing has come out of that either. So I know that the county has made steps toward exploring the salary issues, and due to the county bureaucracy, I think it's not our county alone. It's everyone's government agency. It changes slow. And so, again, I'm just grateful that I have staff that are committed to doing this work and don't mind working weekends and holidays. The other thing I wanted to say is the children's team does not work weekends or holidays. And so the adults team covers for them when they're out. And so that's another additional challenge for the adults team.
Yeah, I'm definitely hearing from all three of you, like, creative scheduling, thoughtful scheduling. And then even, Kristen, you mentioned building in incentives anywhere you can. So being really thoughtful about those things. And Kelly, your coverage, and I think you had mentioned previously cross-training. And so just keeping all of that in mind, how we can support these folks that are doing this dynamic work. We are really close on our time, so we're going to prioritize questions 5 and 6. And 6 is similar to what we just talked about. So we'll move into 5, and if we have time, we'll talk about 6. And if everybody can just do a quick touch on the perspectives of a crisis continuum of care. If you can share the trends regarding triaging, dispatching, and transfer that impact your mobile crisis team, that would be super helpful to bring into this space as well. And Kelly, I'm going to pass it back over to you. Thank you.
Sure. I think that during COVID, with all of the the placement issues that we have experienced across the state, that we've had to look at triaging and figuring out how to serve people at a lower level of care whenever appropriate. And I think that that's trickled down to our law enforcement partners, where they're starting to think more before they place people in 5150s, and they'll call more proactively to us before placing people in 5150s. And I think that that's helping us in triaging in terms of, you know, not having people sitting in beds for days or weeks in the emergency rooms waiting for placement, and trying to find ways that we can move things along more quickly.
Thank you, Kelly. Kristen, can you share with us, from the perspective of a crisis continuum of care, trends regarding triaging, dispatching, transfers?
Sure. Kelly already mentioned, you know, the bed capacity for lower levels of care and even higher levels of care. Obviously, those can impact the mobile crisis teams. One thing that is, I think, important is we're a stakeholder program. So the majority of our requests come from our stakeholders, like law enforcement, emergency departments, APS, CPS, our county clinics, you know, lots of different stakeholders. Schools, we do a whole lot of responses at all of our school districts here. And I think one of the things that can impact our mobile crisis response teams is if we're not staying connected to those stakeholders and making sure that we're on the same page, that can impact our teams in a not great way. And if we are staying on the same page and staying closely connected, then it can impact in a positive way. And I can give a brief example of that. Many of the schools that will request a team out have incorporated us into their protocols. And so the minute there's a risk factor, they automatically call a team. Although they have staff on board who are pretty capable of doing a crisis assessment, but they are not necessarily authorized for a 5150. So in essence, they're calling us just to do a 5150. And so because we have good stakeholder relationships, we're able to reach out and remind them that we're a diversion team. So if you call us out, we're going to do our own assessment. We don't want to put someone through that process of having to tell their story too many times. But we have to do our own assessment because we're going to look for ways to not to hospitalize, right? And so that it was really helpful because the school districts could then look at other ways to help somebody get to the hospital if they knew they automatically needed to, versus, you know, utilizing us more like a PET team than a diversion team. And that's just one example of a billion conversations we have with our stakeholders to make sure that they understand the mission of our program being diversion. And so we don't frustrate them when we come out and try not to do something that they may want us to do.
Yes. Clear roles and goals of the different partners. Thank you so much. Danielle, do you want to share for question number 5?
Sure. I can just, everything Kristen and Kelly mentioned, very much similar to what I would see as well and what I experienced. I think one of the biggest things that I can share in terms of my perspective is triaging calls when they come in. So our calls, we receive referrals from stakeholders as well as parents, self-referred, anyone could call us to request an evaluation. And so it was very important for people to know exactly what we do and how we do it and what are potential outcomes, right? Because when you do place someone on a hold, you're taking away their civil liberties and they should know that. And laws change and laws are different when you're talking about an adult versus a minor. And so in regard to triaging, an impact on mobile crisis team is safety. So there was a shift at the county when I was there from the triaging happening with us. So someone on our team, on our shift, actually triaging calls and dispatching our team. Now it went transitioned over to a call center in the county. And these were, you know, obviously clinicians, mental health specialists, things like that, but they weren't necessarily crisis experts. And being triaging a crisis call is extremely important in terms of safety for who you're sending out to that call. And so there was a big shift in safety concerns for the actual mobile crisis responders on my team and myself when we were being triaged by this new team. And so as much as training as you put into your field staff, staff that are going out and responding to these calls, there needs to be as much dedication and training to triage these calls. Because that was the biggest thing we saw, or that I saw in terms of my perspective and my experience, was safety. There were a lot of safety concerns that came up when I was being sent out to a call that wasn't triaged in a way that was most appropriate for the kind of work we were doing.
Thank you for naming that. And that is such an important point to touch on. We have just a few moments left. So instead of telling the panelists which questions I will prioritize here, I'm going to open it up. We have three questions left. The number six is touching on burnout and compassion fatigue and strategies that help us in those areas. And then we also have, if we can go to the next slide, questions 7 and 8, recommendations and words of advice. And then also, specific information around COVID-19 pandemic and the other disasters and wildfires and things that are impacting us. So I will open this up for you to give any closing remarks, comments, thoughts, advice. And Danielle, I'll go ahead and move over to you.
I'm sorry.
And you can share on any of those that you like at this point. And this is just anything that you want to share in the last moment.
Okay. I would just say, as you know, a former field staff, I'm also a clinician, I still do crisis work. My recommendations for anyone either starting a new program, whether in the planning phase or the implementation phase, is really investing in your teams, right? Not just in terms of salary, but in terms of taking care of them, because this is hard work. It's grueling work. It weighs very heavily at the end of the day. And not everyone can do this work. So if you have people that are doing it and are doing it well, find ways to retain them, find ways to support them, find ways to add to their self-care and their respite, giving them opportunities and hearing them as much as you can. I know the challenges that exist when you're working in counties. And so finding ways and strategies to kind of, you know, navigate around those in order to support your teams is really what it's going to help retain staff in terms of flexibility, right? With shifts, salary, incentives, things like that. And so I feel like that is one of the biggest a very big piece that is helpful for people to understand when you think about field staff and value and honor their work.
Thank you so much. And I think we probably have a lot of those folks in here saying that they want to make sure that that message goes all the way to leadership. And so I hope that it does find its way there. Thank you, Danielle. And we'll go ahead and go back over to Kristen. Any other words of wisdom, advice that you would like to share, or a response to either of the questions that we have up?
Yes, I have to echo what Danielle said, in because I've learned the hard way that has to be the focus and what we look at. If we focus so much on meeting the community needs and not making sure we have the staff to do it, then we can't meet the community needs anyway. And so one thing I just wanted to add, every call that a team member goes on, they are required to consult with a supervisor or a licensed clinician on that call. Even our licensed folks, we still have them consult. And we built that into that as a support. It's not a accountability oversight. It's actually a support mechanism that we found is really valuable to make sure that the team has support, because we can tell when they're on a difficult call, and then we can ask them to come in and debrief about it to really make sure that we're focusing on self-care and burnout prevention. So that's one thing we've learned over the years is really, really important. So everything Danielle said plus that.
Yes. Thank you, Kristen, for underscoring that message and the importance. And Kelly, if you want to close us out here, thank you so much.
Yeah, ditto to all of that. But also, I encourage my staff when there's slow days to just enjoy it and to take it easy, and to take mental health days. Like if you're starting to feel burnt out, I encourage my staff to do that. I know our HR might not like that, but use your benefit leave time. And also as a manager, I'm a middle manager, so I try to make sure I lift up concerns to my administration. And I try to be really engaged with my staff and I show up in person, I support them. And I think that that's been really difficult during the pandemic. Many managers are still working 100% from home and never see their staff in person at all. And I think during the pandemic, that was really hard for my staff to be the only ones in the building showing up in person to work. So showing them that I'm not better than them and that I can show up in person too has been huge. And then lastly, just relationships are worth everything, and to not overpromise. This is about number 7. And, you know, to be clear that you may not have capacity to do certain things, especially with our law enforcement partners. When we started out, I think we may have overpromised what we were going to be able to deliver. And so I've been really cautious to be clear, as capacity allows, we will respond. And that's gone a long way. Being honest is better than leading people on to think that you're going to do something that you can't actually do.
Yes, yes. Aligning what you say you're going to do with what your team has the capacity to do is such a beautiful way to honor the team members that you have. Thank you all for being here today. We appreciate you and all of the work that you're doing to improve your community.